First order of business is to mix a master flesh tone. What we're going to do first is we're going to add some white paint to a cup, followed by some yellow, and finally we're going to add some brown oxide. Okay, once you've added the paint to the cup, you just want to add enough water to thin the paint down to allow it to mix. And I like to use an old brush to mix the paint because it really helps to mix up that pigment. Now you'll notice flesh looks a bit yellowish. So what we're going to do then is we're going to add a little bit of red. And this helps to counteract the yellow. This will give it a little bit more of a flesh color. And since the Phantom's flesh tone was rather pale anyway, that's what we're trying to achieve here, a rather pale flesh color. And you'll see the paint is quite thick, and it really clings to the brush. Now for airbrushing, which is what we're going to begin with, we're going to add a little bit more water, and we're just going to mix this up a little bit more until we get to the right consistency. And what I like to do is I just keep adding enough water until the paint has a certain viscosity. And the way I can tell is I hold the brush right up to the edge of the cup and I watch to see just how quickly it runs down to the bottom of the cup. And since this is a base coat, we're going to have the airbrush nozzle open rather wide, so we're not going to be overly concerned with the paint having to be very thin. Okay, now we've achieved the proper viscosity, and I think the color is pretty good. This is known as the, for this particular model, this is known as the master flesh color. Now, later on, we're going to mix a shadow color and a highlight color. However, the highlight color is going to be mixed so that we can dry brush. The face contains quite a bit of texture, so I'll show you what dry brushing is all about a little bit later on. But we're just about ready to start airbrushing here. Okay, I'm going to be using a Badger Model 150 airbrush. It's an internal mix double action brush. Okay, now what this simply means is the paint and the air mix through one tube. This trigger, as you can see, pulls back, and what that's actually doing is it's sliding the needle through the chamber, thus opening the nozzle or closing it depending on just how much paint you want. And I've had this airbrush now for a little over 15 years, and it does a very nice job. So you'll also notice I just have a color cup attached to the airbrush. I could attach a jar to the bottom here and use that, but most of the time I just use the color cup. I only use small amounts of paint normally when I airbrush something. So the next thing, of course, is to put the paint into the cup and begin spraying. Okay. You'll now notice that the head as well as the hands have received a nice coat of the base color flesh, and the next step will be to apply some highlighting to the face. And as I said before, the face contains quite a bit of texture. I know it's difficult to see on the video, but there are lots of lines in the face. You've got the wrinkles in the forehead, the lines along the sides, the jawline, under the cheekbones, All this is really a dry brusher's dream when it comes to a model, because with all this texture, you can really cover that nice and bring out all the detail. The technique of dry brushing is where you take a lighter variation of the base flesh color, or any color for that matter, and you're going to want to use a brush that looks very much like a powder puff. You want to use a very old brush that is really beaten up, because the object is, you put very little paint on this brush. You simply dip the end of the brush into some paint, and what you're going to do is you're going to wipe off the excess. So you see what I'm doing here? I want a very dry, dusty sort of streaky look. Now there's very little paint on this brush. When I take the lighter shade and I rub it or scrub it against the surface of the model, the lighter toned paint only hits the raised surfaces, leaving the darker color inside all the recesses. That's what really brings out the... Okay, now you begin to see the difference in the tones, how the lighter shade, which is an almost white flesh tone, and you'll notice that the darker, or the base tone, is still showing in all the crevices. And that's really what you're trying to achieve as far as dry brushing. Dry brushing is a dark to light process. Over a darker base coat, you're going to want to do a lighter tone, which in turn brings out the details. Many of the paints I use are Apple Barrel Colors by Plaid. These are acrylic, they come in 2-ounce bottles, and a wide range of colors. Now what I'm going to do here is I'm going to mix up a shadow flesh color. I'm going to be using the brown oxide with just a little bit of pumpkin orange. This takes away a little bit of the brown tone and actually helps the flesh tone out a little bit, gives it a little bit more of a warmer look. And there you have it. The variation of the flesh tone shadow color has been added, and this needs to be softened a little bit. So what we're going to do is, using the highlight color, we're going to airbrush a mist coat over this just to tone that back a tad. Okay, I have now mixed up what amounts to be a dry brush, or rather an airbrush wash of the highlight color, and I'm going to just mist this from a distance over the bust, or rather over the head of the kit, just to tone back some of the shadow color, just so that it's a little bit more subtle than it is here. Okay, there we go. There's the shadow color has been toned back, so it's just a little bit more subtle now. Okay, now we're going to move on to the other shadow color. We're going to apply a little bit of a black purplish tone around the eyes to deepen the eyes, and also on areas of the face. Now what we're going to do is we're going to mix up another shadow color, and we're going to use some Apple Barrel Royal Violet, and we're also going to mix that with a little bit of black. Okay, you'll now notice how the purplish tone has been added, which again is adding the bruised effect. Now we're going to deepen this color a little bit more by going in a little bit tighter, that is a little bit closer with the airbrush, and a much finer line, and we're going to do some black, and that's really going to punch in those shadows. Okay, now we can see that the black tone has been airbrushed on, and I even went ahead and airbrushed around the mouth just to add enough subtle shading around the lips. The mouth will be detailed using other colors. But you can see how the eye sockets are very deep, the lines in the face. Also, I went ahead and airbrushed a subtle line around the hairline. This way, when I paint that the hair black, this will help blend it to the flesh tone better so that it'll actually look like fine bits of hair attached to the skin. And so far, it's taking shape rather nicely. Now what has to happen is we take a can of Tester's Doll Coat, and we're going to... This is a clear lacquer, a flat lacquer, that will protect the paint finish, and so that when I'm applying the other colors, I don't have to worry about marring this particular paint so far. It's just a protective coating that I like to use. I actually use it in between all the different paint coats before I apply the next color. Okay, we're going to first paint the eyes. I have here what I call eye color, oddly enough. The eye color is just a rather off-white tone that is a mixture of white, a little bit of yellow, and just a few drops of black. And that makes, I guess, the equivalent of what would be an oyster gray. But to begin with, we're going to take some of the apple barrel red, and we're going to paint the eyes all inside of the eye sockets. We're going to do the red. That provides the red area around the white. So let's get started with that. I'm simply taking the red right out of the bottle, and I'm just applying it to the eye area. Okay, you can see now that the face has been painted. The eyes, the pupils, the teeth have even been painted. And now I'm blocking in the hair. The hair has been painted, and everything's been finished off. The hair has been dry brushed a little bit, and the entire head has also been sealed now with Dull Coat. So now the next step is to gloss over the eyes and the mouth, and then the head will be finished. The gloss finish is real high-tech stuff. It's Future Floor Wax. You can either use it straight from the bottle, or you can thin it down with a little bit of water to control the sheen. I use a fine point brush, and I'm just going to apply some of the Future over the eyes and the mouth. Now, even used straight, this will require several coats. But again, even the Future can be speed dried using a hairdryer. Well, here's the finished head. All the shading and highlighting done. The mouth has been detailed. The gloss has been added to the eyes as well as the mouth. And it's time to move on to the body. As you can see, I have the white of the shirt painted and the flesh on the hands painted. I'm now in the process of cutting in the black around the white as well as the flesh. And once this is done, I will go ahead and finish off the detailing and do a little bit of dry brushing work and gloss up the shoes a little bit. Once I cut the black in around the white, I went ahead and used a wider brush to cover the remaining areas, the backs of the cape, or rather the back of the cape, the pants, across the collar, and then the next thing was the tie or the ascot. That was done in a dark burgundy color, and then it was highlighted with a mixture of bright red and pumpkin orange. Okay, you can see that the base has received a base coat of black, more like a black wash. I am using this as a base color because I'm next going to dry brush a gray over this. That will bring out all the texture and leave all the recesses or the mortar lines black. So in order to do that, we need to first mix up gray. So of course I'm going to use white, and I'm also going to use black. Simple enough. Okay, here again we're going to dry brush. So what I want to do is I want to try to get as much of the excess gray off of the brush as I can. I don't want a lot of paint. A lot of paint will make the dry brushing appear like some sort of frosting as opposed to a dry brushing. And you simply make sure that the brush is fairly dry, and you're going to scrub or brush it against the or perpendicular to how the lines are. Now obviously I've got lines going in both directions here, so I'm going to go on a slight angle to those lines, and you'll notice how the gray is beginning to just bring out all the detailing that's been sculpted into the stone. Okay, the gray is not going into the mortar lines here at all. And you just kind of want to rub that all over, scrubbing with this brush, or dry brushing, hence the term. You want to get the edges really good. Now sometimes you have to keep working up to a lighter shade depending on the color you start with. This is actually looking pretty good here. I don't want it too light. You just want to make sure you get all the areas. Now I haven't painted the statue yet. The statue will be painted in a dark brown first, then that will be dry brushed with a bronze color, and that will bring out the details in the statue of Beethoven here. And we're just about there. Now what I've done here is I've taken the burnt, or rather the brown oxide, and mixed it with a little bit of black, and created a very dark chocolate brown. I've also thinned it a little bit with a little bit of water. I'm going to add just a touch more. And I'm going to use this mixture to base coat the statue. And I'm just going to brush this on. It doesn't have to give me total opacity. As long as I get good coverage and get it all into the little nooks and crannies and folds, because the uppermost surfaces are going to get the bronze, and then the dark brown will stay in all the little crevices, emphasizing all the folds and detail of the statue. I don't have any bronze, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix a little bit of this folk art antique gold with just a tad bit of brown oxide, as well as a few drops of pumpkin orange. That should give me the appropriate bronze color needed. Okay, I'm now dry brushing the bronze color over the statue. The brown base color just lends itself better to colors like gold, copper, bronze, and brass than black would. Okay, the model is now finished, and it's now time to mount the figure to the base.